Party, Secretary to Government of India, Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs. My friends, colleagues, and stalwarts of public sector enterprises sitting here. Mangunaji, CMD of Australia in public sector enterprises. Kailash, many days I have seen, and compliment for initiative, particularly for public sector enterprises that you have taken. Large many of my friends, CMDs, directors, sitting over here, whom I know personally, other participants, ladies and gentlemen. Well, you heard all my colleagues, and it must have given some idea about how PSU are like. I was really making it a very difficult task when I saw the program's details in the morning to speak on unlocking the potential and assets of public sector enterprises, policies, impact, challenges, strategy, and 10 minutes time. This ironical paradox is only that I have to complete within 10 years' time. Otherwise, I am a disciplined person. I don't propose to exceed. It's a difficult task. So if I fail to touch a large many areas, kindly forgive me, but each topic itself requires a long time to deliberate. So I start quickly without formal complimenting Kailash Adhikari again for organizing this program. Yes, there are 330 public sector enterprises. 220, which Prabhupada told, are the operating ones. 157, which my colleague Bobby told, Mr. Bobby told, is profit making. But there are financially stressed company also, which earlier we called about sick company. So 330 altogether. And with about 11.3 lakhs employees. Government of India has invested 12.5 lakhs crore on all these public sector enterprises. And at the moment, hardly 1.9% of the budgetary support is there for public sector enterprises. That is for particularly the sick units. Otherwise, PSU are in very good shape. And combined together, the total asset with tangible, intangible, current, and non-current asset is of the order of 34 lakhs crore, which is 22% of our Indian GDP. Of course, if you take out the liabilities, you come somewhere around 11.5 lakhs crore, which is comparable with the investment by Government of India and 8% of the government India GDP. On the contribution side, this year also, earlier also, public sector has been contributing a lot in terms of profit, in terms of taxes, dividend, duties. This year, PSU earned a profit of 1.27 lakhs crore. And that too after mitigating 30,000 crores loss, which were made by the financially stressed company. Not only that, they made a huge contribution of 3.86 lakhs crore to Government of India in terms of tax and dividend. Not dividend. If you add dividend, it is 5.1 lakh crore. So, if you take it as a single entity in any of the corporate sector within India or outside, public sectors are contributing maximum to our state economy. So there is every reason for PSU to be proud of this. About 50 PSU have been listed on a stock exchange, which is hardly 5% of the total listed company. But you heard about market capitalization, 17 lakhs crore was quoted, which is almost 13-14% of the total listed company in terms of the market capitalization. And that shows the confidence of investors in public sector. You might have seen about the oversubscription of Coal India Limited, ONGC, EIL, and all that. That gives the confidence of people at large, investors at large, stakeholders at large in public sector enterprise. Next, I must move quickly on policy and impact side. The normal impression and feeling in public sector enterprises is that we are over-regulated, either from government directly through administrative ministry or through various regulations which are exclusively for public sector enterprises, like for example, the RTI, Right to Information Act 2005, is applicable to government sector and public sector enterprises on the pretext that we are holding the public money. It is ironical again, and we wonder if all the private sector are based on non-public money, which in crude words can be called as black money. All unaccountable money is black money only. So there has been a human cry for a level playing field so far as the RTI is concerned. Second part is the heterogeneous, complex, the accountability check system. You have CTO in government and public sectors. You have CAG, you have CVC, you have CVI, you have Competition Commission, now Company Act also. All the three brothers are just like five Pandavas on a one drop the which is public sector enterprises very well. And they are totally worried on this heterogeneity. They are not afraid of accountability. But there is a need of convergence which has been felt by public sector enterprises, that why not one or two accountability check systems there? And that will be a better idea. This is a concern for the sector. Since SCOPE is an apex body for public sector, I have all the courage to tell before you that this is a requirement. Other regulations are there. They are already regulated through administrative ministry on all the passive regulation, that is informal regulations and formal regulations. They have sectoral regulations also, which is a part of the public sector. The Parliament Committee on Undertaking, Public Undertaking, COPU, Estimate Committee, Assurance Committee, Rajbhasha Committee, CST Committee, and all that committee has directly dealing with public sector enterprises. In between, I missed CAG, so I'm sorry. So all this again requires some convergence of all the regulatory. And therefore, in public sector enterprises, there's a general feeling that the overall regulation sometimes are disappointing. Sometimes it is frustrating also. And it appears that the public sector enterprises are undermined by regulations. This is the general feeling I am conveying on behalf of public sector enterprises. They do not speak, they prefer to keep silent. And I myself as a school person. it's a clinker drainage, I run through a little border structure. And the border structure has a typical coalition with functional directors, government nominee directors, independent directors. And all the three wings are of diverse nature, with personalities who have made their mark in respective fields. They are very competent people. But this coalition is equally worse than political coalition, the one that we are facing in yesterday's and the others and all that. What happens that the functional directors, they come largely from within the organization, sometimes from outside also. But they are technical people, be it HR, be it project, be it finance, and so on. But they consider themselves as the last word in the respective domain. So when they sit on the board after joining, they consider themselves still as head of the department of, say, technical, project, or finance, separately, without knowing that now their role is completely shifted. It is very paradigm shifted. There is need of interconnectivity to an alignment with the strategy and vision of the company itself. Therefore, there is a need of capacity building to them. Government nominee directors, who largely come from administrative ministry, in the rank of joint secretary, assistant secretary also. They are civil servants of superb intellectuality, occupying the position of privileges sitting in the ministry. But there is a gap when they come to attend the board meeting. They have a huge gap with the employees of the company. They come to the board meeting and as soon as board meeting is over, sometimes before the board meeting, when they are wanted to the ministry, leave the board meeting. And sometimes they are transferred also between this department. So there is a need of cohesiveness. And as per OECD requirement, you will be surprised to know that at least 17 countries have started eliminating, minimizing the role of administrative ministry in state-owned enterprises. Some of them have completely taken it down when they are following the sovereign body company and the country. The concept of sovereign and holding company and for OECD is that. The sovereign holding company is an apex body with 12 persons as a board of apex body, chaired by Prime Minister of the country, if not Finance Minister. And under it, there are sub holding companies on sector wise, like for energy, one, like manufacturing, another, like for construction, like consulting, four, five, some holding companies. And they are reporting to the FX company without the role of any administrative ministry. So that concept is a latest trend in the corporate governance side. I think they are a need for the country also. And the first thing they have been doing is to have a well-documented ownership policy. Even after 6 decades, more than 6 decades of public sector enterprises, you ask, where is the ownership policy? Because owner is the government. And there is obligation, there is everything there. This should be in the hands of all the stakeholders, so that accountability is decided, checked. We are not having it. So ownership policy is another requirement in public sector enterprise. Third player is independent director. They come from different walks of life, technical, management, now political also. they have made their mark in the respective fields, irrespective of any area from which they come. And they are supposed to apply their independent judgment when they are sitting on the board. Without being influenced through political or social agenda, which the government knowing that they are supposed to do when they are part of the government directly, without having any biasness towards the technical aspect of the functional directors, and they are something like watchdog, a conscience keeper when sitting on the board to ensure that there is no corruption, it is ethical, it is transparent, and all that. Without going into detail, I think all the three names need to be protected. I think I should move to the theme is digital. So challenges part deals with the digital transformation. And the biggest challenge today is to manage the change itself. Because what it appears to be impossible today is going to be the mainstream tomorrow. Slow and steady wins the race, is a studious dogma. Now it is rapid and innovative that will be the issue. Change is like a transplanted organ. When you are not maintaining the conditions, you are likely to be rejected from the system. And change is not going out, it has come to stay here. Churchill said that if you want to succeed, you have to change. And if you want to be perfect, you have to change frequently. That is the situation today, and this is the biggest challenge. What has happened? Industries, companies, technology, consumers, suppliers, investors, all are coming under one band circumference. Not that they are working in the iron coating or one sector only. They have spread their wings. They have crossed their barriers. And this is leading to the concept today for all the CEO, which is the main concern, that you have to collaborate, you have to cooperate, you have to form joint ventures, you have to compete separately. And that is the concern of the public sector as such. Traditional way of thinking is no more there. It has been wiped out now. The old silos of you will wait and see has gone out. The mindset of living in the comfort zone has not to be there, and you must live into some sort of area of ambiguity or protected atmosphere. There is a little space, and you have to manage within that little space to provide some extra light that, yes, you have prevailed. Therefore, what has taken shape is the innovation. And technology is the real enabler, as told by my friends, for innovation. Innovation has become the biggest risk today. And if you are not prepared to take the risk, you do not stand anywhere. Digital transformation is not overnight step that we are seeing. It has gradually come. And corporates, not only PSU, but corporates are deriving maximum benefits for deliverability because prices have gone down with digitalization. Remember 386, computers in the beginning and the price. Laptop, iPad, smart telephone. There has been dramatic change in the price. It sector is what? NGOs is surprised the corporate sector. Leaving aside all the telephony and all that, we have seen that how prices are coming down. And in this world we have to survive. Today, platform of digital transformation like Google, Facebook, Amazon and all that has definitely changed consumer behavior. But that is going to change further tomorrow. There will be new platforms like say cloud controlling, computing, cognitive computing, interfacing through digital, online digital, cyber warfare, robotics, data analysis, all that are taking shape. So all this shows that yes, knowledge has to be the real industry before the corporation and public sector. And I would like to end, because I am exceeding time, with the saying of the great man Winston Churchill, that the future leaders are going to be the owners of knowledge. Let us pursue.